settled up here. While in the story that we've just heard, on this day every year, we really only hear about one procession, which is at the beginning of what was Passover week for Judaism. There were actually, though, two processions that were going on at the same time. One, coming from the west, was Pilate and the Roman soldiers. They were watched warily, no doubt, by quite a few Jerusalem natives. And another procession also entered Jerusalem at the same time, but from the east. It was Jesus and the other pilgrims coming for Passover. So there's a contemporary question to ask. I wonder who drew the bigger crowd? Even without a National Park Service picture, I can tell you the answer to that question. The pilgrims from the east were by far the bigger crowd of participants and watchers. Those two processions make this day one of great contrasts. From the west came a procession that ever since Rome invaded that part of the Middle East was always rich in symbolism. The symbolism that Rome intended and presented was one of violence and death. Here was a good chunk of the Roman 10th Legion's cavalry. They were called the Fratensis Legion. From Caesarea Maritima, they were led by the Roman governor of Judea, Pontius Pilate. Now that's a military and not a civilian position. Everyone would have been in full battle armor. Think of the 1st SS Panzer Division, called the Adolf Hitler Division, which was responsible for any number of civilian massacres in Eastern Europe during World War II. And you'll get a sense of how the cavalry of the 10th Legion was viewed by Judeans. No one could miss the message. Mess with Rome, and you will get your own personal cross. This is a savage, heartless imperial power intended to instill fear and discourage rebellion. The reason why Rome would want the locals to feel afraid was what there must have been about 400 Roman soldiers with Pilate entering Jerusalem. But they were facing perhaps over 200,000 Jewish pilgrims who had come to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover festival, a festival celebrating the freedom of an enslaved people, Moses and the Hebrews, by an empire, Egypt. And they're celebrating that Passover, that festival, while being enslaved by yet another empire, Rome. And Rome wanted to let the populace know that revolution against the empire was a very bad idea. The symbolism that Rome brought was not limited to none too subtle reminder that might makes right. It also represented a very significant theological claim. They marched behind the Roman eagle, which symbolized the power of Rome, and they marched behind the symbol of their own legion, a reminder of who founded them, Caesar Augustus. Of Caesar Augustus, it was said that he was the Son of God, the Lord, the Savior, the one who had brought peace on earth in the Pax Romana. For anyone else to claim those titles or be named by those titles was an act of treason, a civil and theological crime against the state of Rome. Now, from the east of Jerusalem, a large crowd of pilgrims, including Jesus and his disciples, were flowing over the top of a hill called the Mount of Olives and down across the Kidron Valley towards Jerusalem. It was the beginning of the Passover festival, one of the three holy days that all male Jews are required to attend if they live close enough to Jerusalem. So for that week, the population there swelled by fivefold. And here was Jesus, riding a donkey, a Hebrew symbol for the coming in peace of the true king who would bring peace on earth, following the royal tradition of David and Solomon. So which one is the real king? Caesar or Jesus? That would have been the question of the day. Do the people want to live under the oppression of the Pax Romana or live in freedom under the peace of God? They would not and could not exist simultaneously. For the peace of Jesus to come, Jesus was implying Rome had to either go or change. For the real Lord to take his rightful place, for the real Son of God to come into his fullness, the fake news had to be replaced by the good news. So today, Palm Sunday, is a challenging day. The God of war from the west and the Prince of Peace from the east entering Jerusalem together. No doubt Pilate would not have known Jesus from any other Jew on that first day, but as the week went by, as our week goes by, we'll hear more and more about why Pilate would have come to know who this mysterious out-of-towner was and what he represented. The remarkable thing about this day is that it is timeless. The challenging encounter of these two extremes seem to repeat itself over and over again throughout human history. However, the story that we know as we enter into Jerusalem today, as we enter into Holy Week today, began not with might, but with humility. When just a few short weeks ago, we celebrated the birth of Christ as a vulnerable infant, utterly dependent on the God-given gifts of those around him to provide him with what he needed. Throughout his life and ministry, Jesus never lost trust that God was with him, especially in those around him who loved him. When Pilate and Jesus collide in the governor's headquarters in Jerusalem, it was an archetypal meeting of fear versus hope. The annual arrival at Passover of the 10th Legion intentionally provoked fear. But the year Jesus and his followers entered into Jerusalem, their procession was hallmarked by hope. The hope every pilgrim felt as Jerusalem came into view, and especially as each of them became aware of the King of Peace riding on a donkey in the midst of the people. Now, when children are born, so are the dreams of their parents. When Christ was born, all of creation had a dream, and it was a very good dream. Those who followed Jesus into Jerusalem in the days before Passover, they had caught the hope of that dream. The desire for true freedom that is more than only freedom from oppression, but freedom from all fear. They hoped that their children would know no want, that they could worship and practice their faith and self-governance in ways that assured justice for their people. That dream lives even today in the hearts of people in many nations who long for a better, freer life. It lives in the hearts of Sudanese people, of Palestinians, and of the Syrians, who have all known the realities of life lost amidst the daily violence of oppressive force. Even as children die in the arms of their mothers and fathers, the power of the dream continues to cause all to our Jerusalem to confront evil face to face, but then to turn hearts of stone into hearts of mercy and create peace together rather than war. In his book of essays entitled The Immense Journey, anthropologist and naturalist Lauren Isley shares essential lessons about and from the nature of life on earth. In the essay called The Judgment of the Birds, He tells this story from a walk that he took through the woods to the edge of a glade. He writes, "I had sat down to rest with my back against a stump. Through accident, I was concealed from the glade, although I could see into it perfectly. The sun was warm there, and the murmurs of forest life blurred softly away into my sleep. When I awoke, dimly aware of some commotion and outcry in the clearing, the light was slanting down to the pines in such a way that the glade was like some vast cathedral. I could see the dust motes of wood pollen in the long shaft of light, and there, on the extended branch, sat an enormous raven with a red and squirming nestling in its beak. The sound that awoke me was the outraged cries of the nestling's parents, who flew helplessly in circles about the clearing. The sleek black monster was indifferent to them. He gulped, wetted his beak on the dead branch a moment, and sat still. Up to that point, the little tragedy had followed the usual pattern. But suddenly, out of all that area of woodland, a soft sound of complaint began to rise. Into the glade fluttered small birds of half a dozen varieties, drawn by the anguished outcries of the tiny parents. No one dared to attack the raven, but they cried there in some instinctive common misery, the bereaved and the unbereaved, the glade filled with their soft rustling and their cries. They fluttered as though to point their wings at the murderer. There was a dim, intangible ethic he had violated that they knew. He was a bird of death. And he, the murderer, the black bird at the heart of life, sat on there glistening in the common light, formidable, unmoving, unperturbed, untouchable. The sign died. But it was then that I saw the judgment. It was the judgment of life against death. I will never see it again so forcefully presented. I will never hear it again in notes so tragically prolonged. For in the midst of protests, they forgot the violence. There in that clearing, the crystal note of a song sparrow filled hesitantly, lifting in the hush. And finally, after painful fluttering, another took the song, and then another, the song passing from one bird to another, doubtfully at first, as though some evil thing were being slowly forgotten, till suddenly they took heart and sang, from many throats joyously together, as birds are known to sing. They sang because life is sweet and sunlight beautiful. They sang under the brooding shadow of the raven. In simple truth, they had forgotten the raven, for they were singers of life and not of death. There are a number of challenges in every life, but one essential reality is the recurring life challenge to turn away from fear and turn instead toward hope. In our own day, there are many voices seeking to make us fearful, not only of events elsewhere in our world, but also of those who might be standing right beside us as we go about our daily lives. But fear is a soul destroyer. Fear disrupts trust. It challenges hope and distances us from the love that our faith calls forth from us. In the face of a marching column of events and peoples that would command us to despair, the faithful entry of a group of dear friends on a journey together possesses a power far more life-giving to us. The presence of hope, the commitment of love, and the promise of peace are the true gifts of the Nativity of our Lord. Those gifts are with Christ, even as he enters Jerusalem. Fully dependent and trusting in God, he makes his immense journey. I believe that hope is an eternal and innate quality with which every human being is born. Fear is learned. Therefore, our challenge as people of faith is not to find hope, but rather to hold on to our hope in the face of fear. This week, this Holy Week, is about that struggle. The child in the manger may have been stolen from us by death, but the promise of God's dream lives on, and it lives on through us. The Holy Spirit takes wing and sings to us like the angels sang for the shepherds, "Do not be afraid." In our day and in our journey into Jerusalem, to our meeting of fear versus hope, the central question for each of us is, which procession are you a part of? The empire's nightmare driven forward by fear, or the procession of Christ's dream inspired onward by hope? How we get to Jerusalem determines whether we and future generations truly die or truly live. The death or life entering the world within whichever reality we create on our journey, just as it was with Pontius, Pilate, and Jesus. So which journey?